ophthalmologists. And in some cases, we'll take some shortcuts. We won't go in the topic in detail, but things that are necessary to be known, I'll cover them. We'll break this talk up into looking at the optics of refraction retinoscopy and spectacles, optics of indirect ophthalmoscopy, optics of slit lamp exam, and optical tips in getting good smartphone photos. Now, this coverage of optics is not going to be the standard textbook coverage where we have ray diagrams showing you how the images are formed. There'll be some ray diagrams, but only to illustrate practical points. So let's go to the first part, that's optics of refraction, retinoscopy, and spectacles. We start with these simple things like myopia. You all know that in myopia, parallel rays come to a focus in front of the retina, and myopia can be corrected by the use of concave or minus lenses. Now, at this point, it'll be worth stating that the myopia you see in your OPD in young patients is almost always axial myopia. In theory, myopia could be due to a change in the corneal curvature. It could be due to a change in the lens curvature or the lens refractive index, or it could be due to an increase in the axial length. But 99% of all the myopias you see are due to an increase in the axial length. And it's amusing to note that most myopes have flatter corneas than normal. So if you see somebody in your OPD who's got a keratometry of 40, he's likely to be a myope, right? That means, in other words, in myopes, axial length causes the myopia, and corneal curvature kind of adjusts to try and reduce the myopia. And when it cannot manage to adjust, then the person becomes myopic. Now, this previous talk about axial length being the primary determinant is important in understanding the importance of this slide. If you were to be asked that in a unilateral high myope, if you correct him with spectacles, will there be diplopia due to anisocornea? What would the answer be, yes or no? Surprisingly, most ophthalmology postgraduates, and indeed even a few ophthalmologists, will say that yes, there will be anisocornea. The actual answer is no. There will not be any anisocornea. And this is because of a rule called Knapp's rule, which says that the retinal image size will not be different between the two eyes, no matter what the amount of actual ametropia existing when the spectacle lens is placed at the anterior focal point of the eye. Now, notice the ifs. First is actual ametropia, not refractive. Now, why is this important? Because most of us get the impression that actual ametropia, anisometropia will cause anisocornea, because we know that in cataract patients where we render them a phakic and don't put an IOL, there's going to be a 30% increase in the magnification and there will be anisocornea. But that is a situation where there is refractive hypermetropia, not axial. In any axial ametropia, whether it be myopia or hypermetropia, there will be no change in the image size. The spectacle lens is normally put at about, say, 11, 12 mm in front of the eye. The anterior focal point is about 16 to 17 in myopes, but it's close enough for you to be able to make a rule that spectacles will not cause an anisocornea. Now, this is an important point for you to know. That means in the OPD, if you get a patient with minus 1 in front of one eye and minus 10 in front of the other eye, you could give him spectacles. But of course, as with every statement, there are some ifs and buts, which we will go to a little further down the line. That means this myope may yet, in spite of Knapp's rule, get some degree of diplopia under certain circumstances, but that diplopia will not be an anisoconic diplopia. It will be diplopia of a different sort. Now we look at hypermetropia. Hypermetropia is when parallel rays come to a focus behind the retina. That means the eyeball is too short and you correct it with a convex lens. And then there are, of course, different types of hypermetropia. We are not going into all that because we are looking mainly at the optical aspect of it and the aspect that concerns us as ophthalmologists. And presbyopia is the normal loss of near focusing ability that occurs with age. Again, not too much to be said about it Now, this particular slide is important to look at a little carefully because it introduces a concept, and that concept says that biconvex and biconcave lenses, they also function as prisms. Because any lens can be thought of as being composed of a whole series of prisms stacked on each other, where as you go to the periphery of the lens, the angle of the lens, the apex angle of the lens increases. This means that the rays of light get deviated more as you go to the periphery of the lens, where the angle of the prism is higher. And it also means that as you look through the periphery of the lens, it gives you a prismatic effect as well. So this particular concept is important to understand. Now let's look at these diagrams. On the left side, you see a patient or a person where the pupils are not exactly in the center of his frame. They are slightly more towards the inner side, right? The patient doesn't have a squint, but it's just that the frame is large and the center of the frame is a little temporal to the center of the pupil. Now, if you were to put lenses in front of this patient's pupils, which are centered in the frame, but not centered on the pupil, then you would get a prismatic effect. Let's look at the diagram on the right, and let's look at his right eye. Now, in the right eye, you have a minus lens in front of the eye. The optical center of this minus lens is temporal to the patient's pupil, and this means that this lens, when the patient looks through it, he looks through the nasal part of the lens, and it will act as though he's looking through a minus lens, but with also an additional prism with the base in. Right? Now, what will this base in prism do? It will, you know that all prisms deviate the ray of light towards their base, and they deviate the image towards the apex. So this particular lens will deviate the image slightly to the temporal side. Now, in order for the patient not to get diplopia when wearing this glass, he will have to move his eyes out slightly, and he will then get eye strain. Now, whether this is acceptable or not depends upon how much is the prismatic deviation and how much is that patient's fusional range of divergence. So notice we are introducing multiple concepts because they have relevance in this case. So here, first the concept of the spherical lens causing a prismatic deviation if not centered on the eye. And the second is that the eye has something called a fusional range of convergence, of divergence, and even of vertical fusion. Now, you all know that convergence fusional range is about 30 degrees or so in most people, and divergence is only up to about 10, and vertical is only maybe 1 or 2 degrees. Now, this means that this patient with the minus lens in front of his right eye may get a very, very minus strain, or maybe not at all, because he does have some fusional range. But it would also depend on the power of the lens, as we will see in a subsequent slide. And in the eye, in the left eye, in the lower right diagram, here we see the situation where there is a plus lens. And in this case, the eye is forced to move inwards because the apex of the prism is inwards. That means the eye is made to converge. Now, convergence fusional range is very high. So this eye, although it has to converge, but may not find much strain at all, because most people have a fairly large convergence fusional range. Now, when you have a lens, now therefore it means that you need to know where the optical center of the lens is. So you can look that up with a lensometer. There are also other ways to look it up if you don't have a lensometer to figure it out, but we aren't going to talk of those today. Of course, the lensometer also tells you the power of the spectacle lens, but right now we are looking at the point of view that it'll also tell you the optical center. Now we come down to Prentice's rule, which I would say is the single most important rule that you as ophthalmologists must know in your practice. Whenever a person is given a pair of glasses, and he comes back with problems. He doesn't like the glasses. 99.99% of times, the spectacle power given to him by the fitter will be correct. That means it's very rare to find somebody who's got glasses made with the wrong number. But it's very, very common to find glasses which have not been centered well. And to understand, to calculate, and to appreciate whether that recentration is the cause of the problem or not, you need to know Prentice's rule. And Prentice's rule says that each centimeter of decentration of a lens results in a one prism diopter deviation of light for each diopter of lens power. Or the other way of putting it is that you can calculate the prismatic effect of decentration of a spherical lens by multiplying the dioptric power of the lens in diopters with the decentration of the lens from the pupil axis in centimeters, not millimeters, centimeters. So get this right. Otherwise, your calculations will be wrong. If you look at the decentration millimeters, you will get a considerably wrong value. Now, we had talked of the case earlier where you had unilateral high myopia and you gave glasses. And I said that this patient will not get diplopia because of anisocornea. But can he get another type of diplopia? Now, let's assume that this patient is looking up. When he looks up, let's say he has a minus 10 in one eye and only minus 1 in the other. So in the minus 10 eye, if he looks 1 centimeter above the central point of the lens, he will get a 10 prism diopter effect. And in the other eye, he will get only 1 prism diopter at the same point in the glass. Now, what does this mean? It means that he will get a difference in the prismatic deviation of the image of 9 prism diopters. And 9 prism diopters vertical deviation cannot be compensated by the fusion reflex. And so this patient is likely to get issues when he looks upwards or downwards if the frame is large. Now, what if you give him a tiny frame, give him a tiny Gandhi frame and have it fairly close to his eye, right? So that he does not look through the extreme periphery of the lens. Now, in such a case, what will happen is that he will not get diplopia because of anisocornea, and he will not get diplopia because of Prentice's rule either. So you have to see how these two factors play out to decide whether the patient will or will not be comfortable with the glasses that you give him. Somebody is scribbling something on the screen. Okay, it's gone now. Now let's look at presbyopia, the factors that we need to know in correction of presbyopia. Now this diagram shows you a progressive lens, but the same basic theory to some extent would apply to a bifocal as well. Now between the distance and the near part, let me explain it another way. When you are looking at a distant object and then you shift your gaze to a near object, each eye moves down by about 8 mm. And it moves inwards by about 2 to 3 mm. So which means that your near segment has to be rotated slightly inwards, and the ideal distance between the distance and the near segment would be about 8 mm. Right? If it is more than that, then the patient will have difficulty in looking at both distance and near by shifting his eyes unless he also shifts the frame. In the case of progressives, there's also an additional factor to be looked at. And that is that between the distance and the near segments, which are slightly wide, there's a very narrow intermediate segment. And on the sides of this intermediate segment, there is a lot of peripheral distortion. So when you look down, you have to look through this corridor of good vision. If you look through the sides, you're not going to see well. So it means that it is extremely important, much more so than in a spherical lens, because in a spherical lens, as you saw, there were tolerance limits. I mean, you could decenter the lens somewhat and the patient may still not have problems because it is within his fusional range. But in the case of presbyopic lenses, you have to align them perfectly so that the pupils lie in the right area in the distance segment. If you were to have the lens decentered like this, where the pupil is not exactly in the right place or rather the pupil of cause is where is it is, where the lens is not in the right place, then what will happen is that as this patient looks downwards with his left eye, he will go through the distorted area and he will not be happy with the glasses. So in presbyopic glasses, especially progressives, it's extremely important to get your pupil centration right. Now, of course, you aren't going to be the person doing the centration, but you will definitely have to monitor the centration when the patient comes back, and especially if he's not happy with his glasses. And some of you might be saying, you know, why does this concern me? I'm a surgeon. I'm not going to do all this. I'm going to have an optometrist doing it. But patients decide how good your surgery is based on the visual results they get. And if the patient is given a bad glass and he can't see with it, you know, he'll end up saying that this doctor doesn't know what he's doing and he, you know, he's given me a bad result. So you need to know these points, because then only you can give good functional results rather than only good anatomical results. The next thing we look at is astigmatism. And astigmatism is defined as the situation where parallel rays don't come to a point focus on the retina. And this, of course, follows from the name. A means without and stigma means point. So astigmatism is a situation where there is no point focus. And instead of they have two line foci. At this point, we will look at one extremely important concept called the Sturm's conoid. It's very, very, very important that you understand this, because once you understand this, a whole series of points in ophthalmology become very clear. Now, this is a diagram of the conoid of Sturm. When you just look at it like this, it's a little difficult to make sense out of it. You can see, of course, there's a cylindrical pencil or beam of light on the left side, the one colored in blue. But after it goes through the astigmatic surface, which is also called a toric lens, it seems to follow some complicated shape. This shape is called Sturm's conoid. And we've, you know, broken it up in different areas and shown you the profile of this Sturm's conoid at different points. But most PGs, at least I can speak for myself, when I was a PG, I never really understood how to draw this. I used to memorize it, but when I had to draw it, I would always make a couple of errors here and there. But it's really a very, very simple concept. So let's break it down and look at how will you draw the Sturm's conoid. Suppose you had to quickly draw it on a piece of paper, how would you draw it? Now, over here, the first thing you draw is, besides, of course, your central line, the lens, and the cylindrical beam of light, the first thing you will draw is the, let's say in this case, the rays that come from the top and the bottom of the lens, right? Lower down, I've shown a sort of I've tried to show a sort of a three-dimensional depiction. Now, when we look at the rays coming from the top and the bottom, they will obviously come to a focus, a line focus at a certain point. Now, you will understand it's a line focus by looking at the lower diagram. So there's the upper beam and the lower beam. When they come together, they will intersect not at a point, but at a line. Now, this is the beam coming from the top and the bottom, right? So you draw it first. Of course, since you're drawing it in 2D, you will just draw it like you would draw a normal, normal beam coming to a point focus, right? But you will understand that this point that you're seeing is not actually a point, but it's a line, which is, if you're looking in the direction of that line. So it is only seen by you as a point right now in the diagram. The next step is you draw the beam coming from the horizontal meridian, right? Now this beam will come to a line focus at a different point from the previous beam. And then when you see both those beams together, when you see both those beams together, this is your conoid of Sturm, right? Now look here, you will see the vertical beam in red, the horizontal beam, which starts off in green and then shifts its color as it intersects with the vertical beam. And you will see two line foci. You will see a central area where we've shown the cross section of the Sturm's conoid as a circle. and you'll see the extreme corners where there will be ellipses, a horizontal ellipse in the beginning and a vertical ellipse at the end. Now here we showed the vertical rays coming to a focus before the horizontal rays. You could as well draw the Sturm's conoid the other way around, with the vertical rays coming to a focus later and the horizontal rays coming to a focus earlier. It doesn't really matter. It will just shift your Sturm's conoid through 90 degrees, right? So you could draw it either way when you're drawing it to illustrate the point. Now, let's look at how you can use this Sturm's conoid to understand different situations. So first of all, you can imagine that the cylindrical beam of light is entering an astigmatic eye. And depending on the length of the eye, the retina will allow that beam to fall on it at different points. If the eye is short and the retina falls right in the beginning of this Sturm's conoid, where neither of the foci have formed, that means neither of the lines have yet formed, then you will get a horizontal ellipse on the retina, right? And this situation where neither of the beams has come to its line focus is called compound hypermetropic astigmatism. Now let's look at this Sturm's conoid again before we go back to looking at how the eyes affect it. And this Sturm's conoid, there are a couple of definitions to know. One is the Sturm's interval. This is the interval between the two line foci. And the central small circle is called the circle of least confusion. We'll come back to this a little later. Now, as the eyeball gets longer, your hypothetical eyeball, it gets longer. And now the eyeball is coming, is allowing the conoid of Sturm to fall on the retina at the first line focus. This would represent simple hypermetropic astigmatism. That means, in other words, one of the foci have fallen on the retina. So from that focus point of view, the eye is emmetropic, but the other focus has not fallen on the retina, so it is still hypermetropic. Now, when the circle of least confusion falls on the retina, this is called mixed astigmatism. That means one of the meridians is hypermetropic and the other meridian is myopic. In simple myopic astigmatism, the second line focus falls on the retina. So in other words, in one meridian, the eye is still myopic, and in the other meridian, it has already reached emmetropia. And of course, in compound myopic astigmatism, both the meridia are myopic, and you will get another vertical ellipse falling on the retina this time. Now, this was to understand the basic types of astigmatism. But understanding about the Sturm's conoid is also important for some practical maneuvers we do to find the correct power and the axis of the astigmatism. Now, when you're doing these procedures to find the correct power, it is called collapsing of the conoid of Sturm. That means when you're testing, you collapse the conoid of Sturm. Now, when do you collapse the conoid of Sturm? First of all, you use spherical lenses only to find the best possible vision that the patient may have, right? Now, this best possible vision with only spheres is not going to be 6-6. It might be 6-12, 6-9, 6-18. And this sphere that you use to get the best corrected vision in an astigmatic patient without using cylinders is called the spherical equivalent of that patient, of that patient's eye, or of that patient's correction, right? So supposing there's a person who takes -3, without glasses, he's 660, and with -3, he's 612. So that means, and then after you, that when you make it -4, he becomes 618 again. So that means -3 is the best possible spherical glass that you can give him. So -3 for that patient will be the spherical equivalent. Now, once you've found the spherical equivalent, if you also want to find the cylinder, you have to collapse the conoid of Sturm. Now you will realize that your circle of least confusion is in the middle of the two line foci. So if you want to collapse the conoid of Sturm and make the circle of least confusion become a focus, you will have to move back and forth between the two line foci, right? That means you can't just add a cylinder and have him have his best corrected final vision. You will have to, if you add a cylinder, you'll have to reduce the sphere. That's how you collapse the conoid of Sturm. So how do you do it in practice? Once you reach the spherical equivalent, you change the cylinder by some amount in the appropriate direction. And then you change the sphere by half that amount in the opposite direction. That is how you will collapse this conoid of Sturm. You'll understand this a little more in detail with the subsequent slides. And at this point, there's some allied concepts. And one of them is refining the cylinder power in refraction by using a Jackson's cross cylinder. And this Jackson's cross cylinder also is easy to understand once you look at the unique nature of the Sturm's conoid. And the second concept is cutting the cylinder. That means what if you want to give a lesser cylinder, even if you don't mind accepting a slightly lesser vision, so how would you go about reducing the cylinder once you have reached the final refraction? See, we, in the olden days, people started with no knowledge at all. They got the spherical equivalent first, and then they figured out the cylinder. Nowadays, we have an autoref reading. So sometimes we get the final refraction first, and then we have to decide that now we've got a certain cylinder and a certain sphere, and we want to reduce the sphere. So how do we reduce it? Again, you have to use the Sturm's conoid, in this case, not to collapse it, but to expand the Sturm's conoid. Now we go back again and again to our Sturm's conoid to look at it again, right? So there's a circle of least confusion and there's something called a Sturm's interval. So when you collapse the conoid of Sturm, what are you doing? You're reducing the Sturm's interval to zero and you're reducing the circle of least confusion to a point instead of a circle. Jackson's cross cylinder is one way to test what cylinder you require by collapsing the Sturm's conoid in small increments. Now in a Jackson's cross cylinder, if you look at the top figure, it shows you the power diagram, right? Now, what do I mean by the power diagram? The power diagram shows the powers along those axes, right? It doesn't show you how the Jackson's cross cylinder is labeled, because the Jackson's cross cylinder, like all ophthalmic lenses, is labeled according to the axis, and the power is at 90 degrees to the axis. Now, if you see the Jackson's cross cylinder on the left diagram, you will see that the plus 0.5 is written on the top. Now, what this means is that the axis of the plus 0.5 is horizontal, and the plus 0.5 in that direction, you actually have minus 0.5 power, and the horizontal direction has plus 0.5 power. So this is shown in the power diagram on the top, right? Now, if you were to look at the diagram below, that shows you the how you can look at this power diagram. You can think of this power diagram as consisting of a spherical lens of plus 0.5 diopters, right? Along with a cylindrical lens of one diopter, right? So the power diagram shows you that this cylinder can be considered as what is seen in the middle. And if you were to write it out, you will say that this cross cylinder, as it is seen on the left, before you shift its position, it represents a plus 0.5D sphere with a minus one cylinder axis 180 held in front of the patient's eye. And if you flip the cylinder means you just rotate it along its handle, you will find that now the minus 0.5 shows on top and the plus 0.5 shows at the side. That means now what are you putting in front of the patient's eye? You're putting a minus 0.5D sphere and a plus one cylinder with its axis at 180. In other words, you shifted from a minus one cylinder to a plus one cylinder just by flipping the cylinder along its handle. And this allows you to understand in which direction the Sturm's conoid has to be collapsed. If the patient sees better with the minus one cylinder at 180 degrees, then you know that you have to increase the minus one cylinder at 180 degrees. If he sees better with a plus one cylinder at 180 degrees, then you know you have to add a plus one cylinder at 180 degrees. But when you actually add it in the spectacle frame, you have to add it just like the cross cylinder. That means you won't add only a one cylinder. You'll add a 0.5 sphere along with a plus one cylinder, right? This part, I think you may not have fully comprehended, because this needs to be said two or three times. And in different ways, we will say it two or three times as we go through the remaining slides. Now, the second thing I told you about was that what if you have a very high cylinder in your final correction? That means you have corrected the person and you find that he takes a plus two sphere with a minus six cylinder with its axis at 180 degrees, right? Now, for some reason, there can be many reasons, we want to reduce the cylinder. Now, please understand that if with the upper value, that's plus two sphere with a minus six cylinder, if he's seeing six, six, then with the lower value, which is with the cut cylinder, he's not going to see six, six. He's going to see a little less, but only a little less, right? Now, one thing you will notice is, or maybe you won't notice it because we haven't yet got to the formula of the spherical equivalent, but I'm telling you, is that the two values that are shown of the correction, they have the same spherical equivalent, right? Now, how did you come to the lower value from the upper value? You reduce the cylinder by two, right? That means, in other words, you went towards the plus direction with the cylinder, right? And you reduce the corresponding sphere by the same amount, right? When you did that, by half that amount. Now, when you did that, you find that the spherical equivalent is the same. But you don't have to take my word for it. You have to figure out a way to calculate the spherical equivalent yourself. Now, here's a little further explanation about what we mean by spherical equivalent. I had already told you that earlier, but we are repeating it. If in a given case of astigmatism, you were only allowed to use spheres to correct it, then the spherical equivalent of that astigmatic correction is a sphere that would be required to get the best possible visual outcome, which is not going to be 6-6.
Bhatti is talking.
Hanji?
Bhatti is taking a class on basic.
Achcha, okay, you're speaking to someone else. Hanji. And this spherical equivalent, when you found it, if you looked at the Sturm's conoid, what would it do? It would put the circle of least confusion on the retina, right? So the spherical equivalent of any particular actual correction is the algebraical sum of the sphere and half the cylinder. Now, what do I mean by this? If you have plus one and minus four, so you add plus one to half of minus four. So you will end up with plus one and minus two. The net result will be minus one, right? So the spherical equivalent of the example I just gave you would be minus one. It's the algebraical sum of the sphere and half the cylinder. Now, let's get down to some other principles. Retinoscopy. We will be coming back to Sturm's conoid again and again in this whole talk. It's such an important topic, but we'll break from it for a while. Now, in retinoscopy, earlier, in the olden days, all residents did a hell of a lot of retinoscopy, and I wouldn't even bother telling them this, what I'm going to tell you now. But nowadays, everybody uses an autoref. So I think we need to spend a little bit of time in knowing the procedure of retinoscopy and how to apply it. Again, I'm not going into the ray diagrams that tell you what happens, but I'm just going to tell you how to do it and how to interpret it and how to come to a conclusion as to what spectacle lens you would require. Now, when you do retinoscopy, you can get either an against glow or a with glow in both meridians. Now, in an against glow, what happens is that as you move the retinoscope light down, the glow in the pupil moves up and vice versa, as you see in this little animation. Okay, now the implication is that if you get an against glow, it means that the patient is either a myope of more than minus 1D, if the working distance is 1 meter, or he's a myope of more than minus 1.5D if the working distance is arm's length, that is 2/3 meter. In other words, the correction that you apply is the reciprocal of the working distance, right? So if you are at 1 meter, then it means he's myopic of minus one or more, right? If you're working at arm's distance, then it's 3/2 diopters, the correction you need to apply. And if you have a with glow, it indicates that the patient is either hypermetropic or he's myope, emmetropic, or he's a myope of less than minus 1 or 1.5 D, right? So that's the first thing you will conclude when you do a retinoscopy. You just do a glow and you will come to these conclusions. Then you will use lenses in front of the patient's eye and you will neutralize this glow. That means, in other words, you'll keep adding and subtracting lenses till you find that the glow no longer moves. That means it neither goes with nor against, right? And at this point, the lens you require to neutralize it is the retinoscopy value, right? Now you will have two values, one in the vertical meridian and one in the horizontal meridian. Okay, now these values, we are talking about the power, not the axis, right? So when you draw a diagram of the retinoscopy results, it's going to be a power diagram, not an axis diagram. And later you will have to shift it into an axis diagram to get the final spectacle power. So let's see how you go about doing it. Now, the first step is you take the retinoscopy power diagram and you algebraically add minus 1.5 D to the retinoscopy power to arrive at the expected spectacle power diagram, right? So on the left, you find the retinoscopy values. You required minus 6 diopter lenses to neutralize the glow. That means you had a minus glow, and to neutralize it, you required minus 6 in both meridia. And this means that the spectacle power expected is minus 7.5 in both meridia. Now this means it's a spherical lens. Now here, of course, there's not much brains to be required because it's a very easy example. So what would be the expected spectacle power in this case? Minus 7.5 diopters. Things get a little bit more interesting when you have a cylindrical value. That means, in other words, in the vertical meridian, you could neutralize the glow with a minus 6. And in the horizontal meridian, you only required minus 4.5. So the first step will be that you make a expected spectacle power diagram, right? You have a retinoscopy power diagram, you convert that into an expected spectacle power diagram. Now, what happens there? Add minus 1.5 algebraically. So what are you getting? Minus 7.5 on the top and minus 6 horizontally. Now, this particular value of minus 7.5 vertically and minus 6 horizontally can be converted into a spherical lens and a cylindrical lens. So how would you convert it? Let's say you could convert it in two ways. Right now, we'll only see one of the ways. And how to go to the second way, we will see in a future slide by a process of what is called transposition, right? So we'll discuss transposition later. Right now, we'll just consider one of the ways to consider this into a sphere and a cylinder. Now, look at the diagram below. Now, you'll find that minus 7.5 vertically and minus 6 horizontally can be thought of as a combination of two lenses, one which is minus 6 in both meridia, and one which is minus 1.5 in the vertical meridian and 0 in the horizontal meridian, right? The minus 6 in both meridian is very easy to understand. It's a minus 6 sphere. Now the minus 1.5 in the vertical meridian would be a minus 1.5 cylinder. But what would the axis be? Not 90, but 180, because the axis is always at 90 degrees to the power, right? So when you convert from the power diagram to the axis notation, you will see that this minus 1.5, which you're showing in the vertical meridian, will be written as having its axis at 180. Now, let's take another example. This other example, there's minus 1 and plus 2 in the retinoscopy. It converts into minus 2.5 and plus 0.5 in the power diagram for the expected spectacle power. And when you break it up, you can break it up into a sphere and a cylinder. But if you looked at the upper right diagram, that means the power diagram for the expected spectacle power, you'll notice that it's myopic on one side and hypermetropic on the other side. So that means it's mixed astigmatism. So you can understand astigmatism not only by looking at Sturm's conoid, but even by looking at the power diagram of the expected spectacle correction. Now, at this point, we'll look at another concept, the concept of transposition. a very simple way of looking at it is that if you were to talk about somebody's height, you could either say that he is 6 inches taller than 5 feet, or you could say that he's 6 inches lesser than 6 feet, right? And both these would be exactly the same. That means a person would be 5 feet, 6 inches. And it's just like how you used to tell the time in the past. How would you tell it? You would say that the time is 1:30, or you would say it's a 1:45, or it's a 2:15, right? That means, in other words, you would take a reference point and move back from it or move ahead from it. So it's kind of similar that in writing astigmatic corrections, you can use two ways. One is where you use, let's say, the maximum plus possible as the spherical value, and then you use a minus cylinder to explain the exact position on the Sturm's conoid where that person exists. Or you could take the lowest plus value and then add a plus cylinder to explain it, right? Let's take examples to understand this. Now, let's take the value on the left side. This value on the left side, this value is of the power diagram of the expected spectacle correction. So it is minus 2.5 vertically and minus 0.5 horizontally. And you could break it up into a minus 0.5 sphere and a minus 2 cylinder with its axis at 180. You can see that from the breakup of the power diagram in the upper figure. Now, you could also do it another way. Look at the lower figure. You could also break it up as a minus 2.5 sphere. And in this case, now what will your cylinder be? It'll be plus 2, but at 90 degrees. Now, if you add up the sphere and the cylinder on the right side, you'll find that you get the power diagram on the left. So both the ways of doing it lead to the same spectacle power diagram, right? So that means they must be equivalent. So in other words, when you have two values that are transposed from a minus cylinder form to a plus cylinder form, those two values actually are exactly the same. They are just a different way of saying it. Like I gave in the height example, where you say 6 inches below 6 feet or 6 inches above 5 feet, you actually are talking about the same thing. It's not a different thing. Similarly, these two transposed values, they describe exactly the same lens. So you're not doing something and changing the lens or changing the way it's manufactured or doing anything. You're just changing the way you are describing it. Now, why this is required, that's another topic, not for today. But just look at it and say that if there's somebody who knows all this well, you don't have to transpose for him. He can figure it out himself. But sometimes you might want to transpose for various reasons. But remember that these two transpose values are not different lenses. They are exactly the same lens, just expressed in a different way. And of course, you know, you're not going to sit and draw power diagrams every time you want to transpose. So there's a simple formula for it. And how do you transpose? You algebraically add the sphere and the cylinder. This gives you the new sphere. And the new cylinder is exactly the same as the old cylinder, but it's of the opposite sign and with the axis shifted through 90 degrees, right? Now, let's say you take one value, minus 0.5 sphere with a minus 2 cylinder axis 180, and you want to transpose it. So you add minus 0.5 to minus 2, what do you get? Minus 2.5, which is a new sphere. And what happens to the cylinder? Power remains the same, sign changes, axis changes. So it becomes plus 2 at 90 degrees. Now the option 1 and the option 2, as I mentioned before, are actually referring to exactly the same lens. You write it in either form you want, it means the same thing. Another optical point you need to know is the duochrome test. The duochrome test is really very simple. If you see rays of light when they are deviated by any refracting surface, they not only bend, but they also break up into a spectrum. And short wavelengths bend more. So in this case, green, being a shorter wavelength, bends more. So it comes to a focus on the retina quicker. And the red wavelength comes focus later. But where do you really want the focus? You want the focus somewhere in between. That means you want the retina following somewhere in between the green and the red focus, right? that's where you get the best result with white light, which contains both green and red. So you can ask the patient to look at red or green objects or letters, right? And you can change the power of his spectacles. And if he sees better with the green letters, that means if he sees the green letters better when a particular lens is put in, it means that the green rays are focused on the retina, but the red rays are not. So that means you have undercorrected a hypermetropia or overcorrected a myopia. Okay, so you just look at this diagram, you can figure it out. So you either undercorrected a hypermetropia or overcorrected a myopia, right? And if he sees the red better, it's just the opposite. So you can use the duochrome test to fine tune your refraction, your subjective refraction. You can also use an astigmatic fan. And I think I see one or two people, their eyes are shutting. So I think we'll skip the explanation of the astigmatic fan and go ahead. But the astigmatic fan can also be used to fine tune the cylinder, the axis as well as the amount of the cylinder. And let's go down to the optics of indirect ophthalmoscopy. And this, I think, will be a little more interesting topic for most of y'all, because you all plan to do a lot of IOs. In this COVID day, y'all are hopefully going to be doing only IOs and not going to be doing any direct ophthalmoscopies. So let's look at indirect ophthalmoscopy. Again, we are not going to go into the complicated ray diagrams of how the image is formed. We are only going to go through simplified ray diagrams that tell you the important features that you need to be aware of in indirect ophthalmoscopy. But we will have some simplified ray diagrams to illustrate the concepts. Now, if you look here, you'll see that there are two ray diagrams that I've shown. So how do you, what am I trying to say in these two ray diagrams? You'll all know, let's deviate for a minute. When you'll talk about a slit lamp, we say it's a slit lamp biomicroscope. That means, in other words, there are two components to it. There's an illumination component and there's an observation component, right? And in the slit lamp, it's very easy to understand. The illumination component is in one arm, the observation component is the other arm. They are mechanically and physically separated, so you can easily understand the concept. In indirect ophthalmoscopy, you have the same principles. That means you have illumination and you have observation. But here it's a little more difficult to understand, because the illumination system and the observation system is the same. That means the indirect ophthalmoscopic lens is going to be used to illuminate the inside of the eye, and the indirect ophthalmoscopic lens is going to be used to image the retina, right? So that is why the condensing lens, what is called a condensing lens here, is also called a condensing imaging lens, right? You can call it many things. You can call it a indirect ophthalmoscopy lens. You can just call it a condensing lens, or you can call it a condensing dash imaging lens, right? But the point of calling it a condensing imaging lens is to put it into your perception that this lens both illuminates the eye as well as images it. So the upper diagram shows you the ray diagram of the illumination. And one very interesting point to note is that where does the ray come to an early point focus? Somewhere in the middle of the lens. Now, this is a way by which you can tell whether somebody else who's pretending to do indirect ophthalmoscopy is actually seeing the image or not, right? And it's also a way that, supposing I wanted to make you see the image, so how would I do? How do I do it? I would do it by arranging the lens in such a way that I can see the focus light coming to a focus somewhere in the middle of the lens. Once it comes to a focus somewhere in the middle of the lens, you will see the fundus, right? And if somebody is not getting the cone of light focused right in the middle of the lens, then he isn't seeing the retina. He's just pretending. Okay, so this is the practical implications of it. That means you've got to have the focus right there. And similarly, if you're showing somebody else, you'll put the lens and you'll know you're at the right distance from the eye when you'll see the cone from the side, because you're holding the lens for somebody else to see. Now, only the other person can see the picture. You can only align the lens. So when you align it in such a way that the beam, the cone, let me show it with a mouse. This cone, right? This is coming to a focus somewhere in the middle of the lens. At that time, the observer will also get to see the picture. And the lower diagram, it shows you the beam path for the creation of the image. Now here a point on the retina is imaged by the condensing lens between the lens and the patient's eye. Now this is an important point, because when you first start doing indirect ophthalmoscopy, you naturally assume that the lens, that the image is towards the patient side of the indirect lens. So you move your eyes in such a way that you're focusing beyond the lens. And maybe we'll go into it and maybe we won't, but you also have heard about physiological diplopia. So if you're looking beyond the lens instead of looking in front of the lens, you will find the image of the retina will be seen, but it will be seen as double, because you're seeing getting physiological diplopia, right? If you converge your eyes so that you're focused your eyes on a point in front of the lens, then you will see the image clearly as well as single. Right? So the second diagram tells you that the image is in front of the lens. And later when we go into smartphone photography, you'll also understand one little, you know, if you want to put up Instagram pictures or something like that, you can hold a vitrectomy lens, a vitrectomy instrument, or some assistant can hold a vitrectomy instrument in between the condensing lens and the image. And in the picture, it will look like it's actually inside the eye. Right? So these are just little subtle, little extra things that you can use this diagram to understand. But basically, this diagram is to tell you that illumination of the eye and imaging of the eye are two separate things, but both of them are done by the lens at one time. This, of course, is your standard diagram, which tells you how indirect ophthalmoscopy is done. And here you'll notice that in the earlier diagram, we just imagined that only one eye was looking at the one eye of the observer was looking at the eye of the patient. And here you see two eyes of the observer looking at the patient's eye, right? And in the next couple of diagrams, we'll understand why you need that contraption in front of you. Now you can see the fundus without the need of this head indirect. You know, you see people putting a head indirect on, you don't need it. You can see the fundus even without it. So then why do you use the head indirect? You basically use it so that you get stereopsis of the picture you're looking at. If you were not to use the head indirect, but you just hold a torch in front of your eye and do indirect ophthalmoscopy, you will get to see the fundus, but it'll be a monocular view. And why is that? So for that, we need to look at a couple of concepts. Now here, I'm not really going to tell you that many facts. It's mostly concepts, and you can apply these concepts in different situations. So the two concepts you need to understand, one is the concept of a stereo base, and the second is the pupil size. These two things affect whether you get stereopsis on indirect ophthalmoscopy or not. Now, what is a stereo base? Very simply put, it's the distance between your eyes. Now, I very vaguely remember when we did physics we used to have something called intersense. You all must have had the 12th. So there was something called the range finder. Now in the range finder, you had two little mirrors, you know, or two little things. You aligned first perpendicular to one side of that rod, and then you align with a protractor from the other side of that rod at some distant object. Correct? And you use the angle that you got to find out how distant that object was. Now, when you're doing stereopsis, when your eyes are getting stereopsis, they're actually using the same principle of the rangefinder. Your eyes are a certain distance apart, and they have to be a certain distance apart. Otherwise, the rangefinder information doesn't apply. You need that angle, you know, to see how far away something is. And the brain interprets that angle and gives you the impression of depth, right? So obviously, if your eyes are wider apart, you have a wider stereo base, and the impression of depth you get is better. And if your eyes are closer apart, then the stereo base is smaller. So the impression of depth you get is less. Okay, so we will play with the stereo base to get stereopsis at all times, But you have to understand that when you get stereopsis with a smaller stereo base, the stereopsis is not quite as good. And the second thing that affects you is pupil size. Now, let's look at the next diagram. Now, this on the right side is the observer. The left side is the patient. Now, you will notice that for a given degree of pupillary dilatation, the rays coming from a certain point on the retina may or may not enter both the eyes. Okay? Now, in this situation, we have shown them not entering both the eyes. Now, in this case, if you were to use a torch and do indirect ophthalmoscopy, only the left eye would get the picture, not the right eye. The right eye wouldn't see anything at all. So you wouldn't get stereopsis, right? But you would get a picture. Now, if the pupil dilated, then possibly you could get stereopsis. Perhaps, maybe, maybe not. Now, not only that, but if you stretched your arm out more, you increase the distance, then obviously the rays are more likely to reach the pupil of your upper eye as well, right? Of course, here it's a top view, so it should be right and left, but I'm just saying upper eye and lower eye to illustrate the point. So then your top eye also would get the ray if you stretched your arm out more. Similarly, if the patient was myopic, then also there is a higher chance that you would get stereopsis. So in other words, occasionally you may get stereopsis even with your own eyes, with the pupils 60 millimeters apart, under certain circumstances, well-dilated pupil, myopic eye, arm stretched out. And that stereopsis is much better than the stereopsis you would get with a indirect ophthalmoscope, for reasons we'll see in a minute. But of course, most of the time you wouldn't get stereopsis at all. So it's like, you know, like they say, California or bust. So it's stereopsis or bust, right? So either you get the best stereopsis in the world or you get none at all. That's when you do indirect ophthalmoscopy with a torch. But you want to be more consistent. You want to get stereopsis all the time. So what do? You bring your pupils together, right? Now you can't actually bring your pupils together. So you use an optical trick to bring your apparent pupils together. So what do? You see this diagram. The acceptance is by those two prisms at 15 mm away from each other. So here the stereo base is 15 mm. And then they are spread out and thrown into your eyes. Your eyes are still at 60 mm apart, the pupils, but the effective stereo base has now become 15 mm. Now, with a 15 mm stereo base, you're much more likely to get stereopsis in most situations with a dilated pupil. But if your pupil is not dilated, what happens? Again, you don't get stereopsis because even 15 mm is not enough. So you have something called a small pupil indirect ophthalmoscope where these prisms are only 6 mm apart, right? But will the stereopsis with 6 mm be as good as that with 15 mm? No. Right? So understand this. Don't buy a only small pupil ophthalmoscope. Either buy a normal one, right? And do without it or get a monocular view on small pupils. Or buy a all pupil one where you can move a little dial and you can go to full pupil or into 15 mm or 6 mm options, right? That means the so-called dilated pupil or the small pupil option. You follow? Now, in addition, you also may have to move the light a little bit so it comes closer. So that's another setting you have to do in the indirect binocular ophthalmoscope. So please understand, in summary, you don't need a head indirect ophthalmoscope to do indirect ophthalmoscopy. You can do it with just a torch and an indirect lens. But when you do that, you're not going to get stereopsis, right? Unless certain conditions are met. And when you use an indirect ophthalmoscope, then you get stereopsis. And in ophthalmology, stereopsis is important. When you see a CSR, you want to see it's elevated or not. You know, you could, of course, guess it's elevated from monocular clues, but seeing it or feeling it, your brain, you know, kind of feeling the elevation is a much better option. And for that, you need a head indirect. Now, here is the same thing shown again and in a different way. Now, on the left side, you see the left and right rays imaged in the patient's pupil with a dilated pupil, right? And also the illumination. Now, notice the illumination cannot be completely coaxial, but it cannot be too far away either. Otherwise, it won't enter the pupil. I told you these are two separate things, illumination and viewing. So if the pupil is smaller and the illumination is not almost coaxial, then you won't get a view. So in the small pupil, you'll notice everything comes closer. The pupils come closer. I mean, when I say pupils, you understand what I mean. And the light comes closer. Sorry. So that you can view as well as illuminate. And the same thing is shown in different ways in all the diagrams. But I think once you got the point, you don't need to look at all the diagrams. Now, the next point you have to understand is magnification and field of view of the indirect ophthalmoscope lens. This is important because you've got to decide which lens you want to buy as the first lens. Of course, ultimately, you might want to buy all of the lenses, but they're expensive. So you have to prioritize. And for that, you need to know the trade-off between magnification and field of view. Now, there's a simple formula that tells you the magnification of the lens. And that is the dioptric power of the eye, which we'll approximate as 60, because we are all poor at maths, otherwise we would have been in IIT. So we won't say it's 55.8 or 58 point whatever, you'll say it's 60. And the dioptric power of the lens is 20. So if you have a 20 diopter lens, what is your magnification? It's it's three times. For a 30 diopter lens, it would be two times. For a 14 diopter lens, it would be, well, nearly 15. So that would be four times. Okay, there are some other issues also. And we won't go into those issues. We'll just take this approximation because this is good enough for us most of the time. If you want to be, you know, somebody in research, then there are other factors which you can go into, but we won't go into that today. And the field of view is the opposite of the magnification, right? If the magnification is more, the field is less, and vice versa. And the next chart will tell us a whole lot of data about this, but I don't really think you need to bother remembering it. Just get a rough idea. So now these are the different fields of view and the magnification of different types of indirect ophthalmoscopic lenses. All these tables are available everywhere. If you take a catalog of any company that makes them, they'll give you all this data. Now here's a practical illustration. Now you see here on the right, indirect ophthalmoscopy being done with a 20 diopter lens, and on the left with a 40. Right, we just cursorily look at it, it almost looks like they are the same. But then look at two points. One is the magnification. It's much less on the left picture. Secondly, if you see this nevus over here, can you see my pointer? Is the pointer also coming through in the screen share? So this pointer is over a small choroidal nevus. Now notice here, on the right side, the nevus is here, right at the periphery. Here it's here. On the left side, it's over here. So you can clearly see that the field in the 40 diopter lens is considerably bigger than the field on the 20 diopter lens. But of course, you just can't take all these figures as absolute all the time. In handheld indirect ophthalmoscopic lenses, this can be taken as a gospel truth, because when you illuminate the eye, the way the illumination is done, you do something called total flashing. That means when you illuminate the eye the way I showed you with the focus near the lens, almost the entire retina is illuminated. Now that may not happen when you use an indirect ophthalmoscopic lens with a slit lamp. With a slit lamp, the slit beam is considerably smaller. So you may have a situation like this. On the right side is your normal 20 diopter lens, or maybe 30, I don't remember. And on the left side is a view with a Meister lens, which would be something similar to a indirect ophthalmoscopic lens on the slit lamp. Now you just look at it this way, and you would think that the magnification, the field of view is the same. But I just said that the view on the Meister should be much bigger, right? So how do you reconcile this? You reconcile this by understanding that the field of view of the Meister is much bigger, but the illumination is much smaller. Remember what I told you in the beginning, indirect ophthalmoscopy has two parts to it, illumination and viewing. Okay, so you have to think of these two separately. With handheld indirect ophthalmoscopic lenses, the limiting factor is not the illumination. The illumination illuminates almost the entire retina, and the field of view you get is less. With Meister or any other indirect ophthalmoscopic lenses, 90D, 78D, is the other way around. The illumination is small, the field of view is big. So you will get the field of view, but you have to scan through it. That means you'll have to move your slit lamp up and down to achieve the full field of view, right? So it may appear the fields of view are the same, but the laws of physics still hold. And this is to show you another two photos. And that is just to introduce a concept, but we are not going to go into much detail. And that is the concept of stereo photos, right? Stereo photos are, you could talk of it as an optical phenomenon or a brain phenomenon or whatever. Now, how do you get stereo photos? Actually, it's very simple. You just have to see the same picture from slightly different angles. Slightly different angles. And when you put those two pictures together, you get a stereo photo. You can also see the same picture at the same time from a slightly different view. Now, how would you look at these stereo photos if you had to look at them? Are you all aware of how to look at stereo photos? I'll just tell you in brief, but sometime later we can probably have a talk just on stereo photos and how to look at them. Now here, the way to do it is by using physiological diplopia, the simplest way. You have two pictures lying side by side and you can use physiological diplopia to get stereopsis. Now, what do I mean by this? You know that if you cross your eyes, right? When you cross your eyes, you're focusing on near point. So all objects further away from that are seen as double. So if I were to cross my eye, which most young people can do quite easily, as though you're squinting, looking at your nose or whatever, you'll find that immediately you'll start seeing four images, right? Two of the right side, two of the left side. And by adjusting the mount you're squinting, you can get the middle two images to overlap. And this, for reasons we'll talk about in some other talk, will fulfill the conditions for stereopsis. And in that middle picture, you'll get stereopsis. You won't get it in the two side ones, right? Now we talked of four and now suddenly I'm talking of three because you're adjusting the mount you're squinting to get two of the pictures to overlap. So you'll now end up seeing three pictures, two side ones without stereopsis and the middle one with stereopsis. Okay, so we just leave it at that and we won't talk much further on stereopsis. But the principle behind seeing a stereoptic picture is the principle of physiological diplopia. Now let's look at some optics which apply to the slit lamp. Again, as I said, I'm not going to talk about those complicated diagrams, but we'll talk of some simple diagrams just to illustrate a concept. And again, as I mentioned, there are two parts, the magnifying part and the illumination part. And you manipulate these two parts separately to get the best out of your slit lamp. Illumination system can be two types, Zeiss type, Hagstrike type. Zeiss type comes from below. That means the bulb is below, it goes through the column, and then there's a prism above which throws it into the eye. Diagram on right. And the illumination, the observation system is mounted on another column. Now, whatever the type of slit lamp, two things to be noted that the slit beam is first, is the same point at which the observation arm is focused. That means both of them are focused at exactly the same point. Not just in terms of how away from you, but even in rotational terms. That means if you rotate the slit lamp, it stays at exactly the same point of focus. Another way of saying the same thing would be that when you're looking at a patient through the slit lamp, let us say that you focus on the cornea. That means you get a clear image of the cornea and then you narrow the slit and you have it. And then you rotate the slit. You'll find that the point at which the slit is focused will remain the same. It will remain in the center of your point of, in the center of your observation area, right? It will not move from left to right or up to down. That means it will stay stuck in the middle. It has been aligned with the mechanical arm to stay in the middle of the observation area. Okay, you can vary this and we will come to that in as always a later slide. But you must understand that in most of the Zeiss types, it's a little difficult to break that alignment. It's always aligned. Though in, of course, advanced Zeiss types, you can do that. But in basic Zeiss types, the alignment is always there and you cannot break that alignment even if you wish. In Zeiss types, okay? Now, here it is possible for you to break the alignment if you wish. Under normal circumstances, the alignment holds. It's a very ingenious principle. In this, what happens is that the light, the bulb, is not focused, right? It's not focused on the slit. It's focused instead on the illuminating lens. And the slit is focused on the eye, right? If you were to just take a lens and focus the bulb, which is, but in co-illumination, you get a homogeneous slit. But again, that's not important for you all in practice. You just get a slit, you're good enough. That's good enough for you. Now, the microscope is based on, wants to know that. And but there are two basic types, the Grinnell type and the Galilean changer type. In the Grinnell type, that's your classical Hagstrike, there's a little lever at the bottom and you flip the lever to change magnification. Now in this type, you have an objective, or rather you have an eyepiece, and you have two sets of objectives, which when you, how many magnifications would you normally achieve with this? Two. If you change the eyepieces, you can end up with three or four, depending on which eyepiece you change to. Okay. Now, in the other type, which is called the Galilean type, you can get more magnifications. Now, how is this achieved? You have an objective lens, a single lens, unlike the Grinnell type where you had two sets of lenses. Here, you have a single lens, which is the object. Introduce what is called the Galilean spectacle. I think we'll hurry up because the time is also getting over, but we'll hurry up a little. So you use a Galilean system in between, and this Galilean system, which is introduced in between, can be aligned in different directions and give you up to five steps of magnification. And you can also get further magnification changes by changing the eyepiece. This all you don't need to know, but this focal, that is the slit and the microscope, are focused at the same point. This is to show the same thing again. Now, how do you dissociate this power focality? This is actually, you really need to know it if you want to take good pictures, or even if you want to see the patients using all the different types of illumination that you may have read about. This dissociation of power focality can be done in the Hagstrike type by turning that little knob that you have the arrow pointing to. And this allows you to rock the illumination beam. And when you dissociate this power focality, you can have a situation where you're focused on the middle of the cornea, but the light is on the sclera on the left. Or you're slightly off coaxial, like in the photo on the right, and you can get a very good to get sclerotic scatter. Dissociating the power focality is necessary. And fundus examination also can be done by the use of ancillary lenses. These are basically required to neutralize the refractive power of the cornea. You also have lenses like the Ruby lens, which directly neutralize it. And you have other lenses like the Goldman 3 mirror, which neutralize it by coupling with the cornea. This slide we'll jump through because we're running short of time. And we go through the fact that there are different types of contact lenses and you can use them for seeing the fundus. And if you use a lens with a very large field, you can get pictures like this where you can get the retina and a dislocated lens in focus at the same time. And which, as you know, have different fields. When you use them with a slit lamp, even though they intrinsically have low magnification, you can increase the magnification available by using the magnification of the slit lamp itself. And then you have the optics of gonioscopy. Now you're all aware that rays from the angle I don't exit from the I at all. They are sent back into the I by total internal reflection. So you need a gonioscope to get these rays to come out. And if that happens, you can then take a view of the angle of the anterior chamber. Now let's look at the miscellaneous topics. As it was your eye, and this gives you magnification, right? Now we won't go into the optical details, but we'll just go into the fact that it gives you magnification. If you were to invert the arrangement, that means if you were to have the minus lens away from your eye and the plus lens close to your eye, it will give you minification. And such a Galilean system is used in the slit lamp for giving you multiple options. So you'll have an eyepiece and an objective which gives you one magnification, and you'll have a Galilean system in between that will give you another two, because you can get increase in size by using it like a normal Galilean and invert it to get reduction in size of the image. The second use of a Galilean glass is in your 6x loops and in low visual aids. And you can also use a Galilean system in lenses which are used for things like macular degeneration, so that they magnify the image inside the eye. But here is an interesting point, that the ultimate Galilean glass, this is, like they say, going back to the future. The ultimate Galilean glass is when you operate a patient and don't put an intraocular lens. What do I mean by that? When you don't put an intraocular lens, it's as good as you added a minus lens to that eye, inside the eye. And outside you have a phakic glasses, which give you 30% magnification. So the ultimate Galilean glass is the old system, where you never put a lens inside the eye, but you just gave a phakic glasses. Sumit, should we go on in more detail, or should we quickly wind up?
No. I think we can wind up, sir. It's already 9:40.
Yeah, okay. So then these slides, we'll just race through them. When you want good pictures with a smartphone, there are some concepts. One is that the entire picture, the camera assumes it adds up to mid-gray. If the picture actually adds up to mid-gray, then it automatically comes correct. Now, supposing you are doing IO photos with a smartphone, everybody complains that their photos are all washed out. The reason that happens is that the camera light meter tries to make the whole big picture mid-gray. Now, in order to make it mid-gray, it has to overexpose the indirect picture. So if you want a correct exposure, you have to go into your smartphone settings and use -2, more if possible, but at least -2. And then you'll get a picture like that on the left. And the same logic works when you're using a smartphone for doing slit photos, because there's a lot of black all around. And if you don't want that black to influence the exposure, you got to underexpose. And for the second concept is that you've got autofocus in your smartphones. And if you have a large field of view, the camera will focus on your fingers, on the patient, and all sorts of things. So if you zoom up and only the indirect ophthalmoscopic picture fills up the entire smartphone screen, you're more likely to get accurately focused pictures like you see here. And I think that ends today's talk. Now, does anybody want to ask any questions, or are you all already sedated enough?
So there are certain questions that they have asked in the chat. Hello, Neeta ma'am?
Huh? Right.
So I will be asking you one or two of that, because okay, there are multiple.
Right. Okay.
So just a minute, sir. One of the question was,
I see one lens here is, what are aspheric lenses?
Yeah, correct.
Okay, so for that, let me share another drawing program, and I'll quickly draw and show you on that. Just give me a second. One second. Just give me half a second.
I think the children have a lot of questions, sir, because very heavy talk. Most of them probably have not done most of it in their residency.
Yeah, but I think you cover, take two or three questions and we'll answer them. The rest we can leave for a future time. Okay, now this part about what is an aspheric lens, right? Let me share another screen. Okay, now this is just a normal drawing program. Now, whenever you have any lens, one way of looking at the lens is that there is a certain profile of this lens. This is the profile of this lens. Let us say you got a stick running through the middle of this profile and you rotate the stick. When you rotate the stick, this profile will create a surface, right? Now, if this profile is part of a circle, I mean, this is a circle, right? And this is a radius, and this is equal all around, then the lens that is created will be a spherical lens. Now, if on the other hand, this profile is anything other than a sphere, for instance, it could be like this, or it could be like this, right? Then it is called a spherical lens. So that means an aspheric lens. So an aspheric lens is any lens which is like a spherical lens created by rotating a profile around the axis, but which is not a sphere. So here, what will happen is that the contour of the lens will be the same in any radial axis, but it will not be a sphere. So these are aspheric lenses. Now, what is the advantage of an aspheric lens? Now, you know that spherical lenses have certain aberrations, spherical aberration, chromatic aberration, so many other aberrations. Now, by using spherical lenses, by changing the curvature at different points on the periphery of the lens, some of these aberrations can be corrected. Now, you can't have a standard aspheric lens that corrects every aberration, but you can have spherical aspheric lenses that correct some aberrations. Okay, what was the next question?
People asked how to prescribe prisms. Now, I think that's a very huge topic to answer.
Yeah, how to prescribe prisms is a huge topic, but I'll say it very simply. Very, very simply. I mean, the only thing worth remembering is what Dr. Jahangir used to tell us. And he said, you remember what I told you earlier? That what does a prism do? It deviates the ray towards the base and it deviates the image towards the apex, right? And you can draw diagrams and validate it, but the only mnemonic you need to remember is relieving apex towards rat, right? That means if you have an esophoria, you need to put a prism with the apex. If you want to correct the diplopia in an esophoria or an esotropia, how should your prism be kept? With the apex towards the inside. That means towards the fovea. Now you remember this and basically you got it all. You just have to start applying these rules in various places. Now suppose you wanted to exercise the person. Then what do you do? Opposite. Because now you want to increase the strain, right? Rather than relieve the strain. Okay. Any other questions?
Most of it is a repeat of what you have already taught. They have not understood it because of the constraints of time. What I would suggest to all the kids is that go back on YouTube, re-watch the whole thing, because it's a little difficult to understand, but once you read it again, you will follow it. Despite that, if you have a problem, come back to us, we will teach you again.
Yeah, what we could do is you just compile the questions. I won't give answers for it yet, but if the students wish, we can have another session where we only answer the questions.
Yes, sir. That
actually not understood what has been taught.
No, that's one thing. That's why I don't want to answer most of them now, because like you said, if they go and watch the same thing 2-3 times, some things will get clear automatically.
Maybe, sir, we can give them a few examples of spherical equivalent transposition, because certain children are saying, can we have few more examples because they have not understood it. So maybe we can just put it on the PG group, certain questions. And they could come up with the answers, and after a day or two, we can give them the answers so they realize where they have been.
Yeah, you could do that also. But what do they want? They want examples of transposition and they want examples of.
Few questions of transpositions, few questions of how to do spherical equivalence. What is asked in their exams,
And that's very, very important, because although I didn't touch upon it, but understanding these concepts really allows you to understand even IOLs. Believe it or not, although I didn't go into optics of IOLs, but understanding all this is useful.
Sir, it was a very nostalgic lecture for me. I went back 20 years when you had taught us all this.
Okay. So I think we'll call it a day right now.
Yes,
and,
sir.
And however you organize
the... the question is not an issue.
Yeah, however you organize the follow-up, we can then do it accordingly.
I'll first put it across to you, you can approve and then you can send it.
Fine.
I'll do that, sir. So it will save time for you.
Yeah, fine.
Yes.
And thank you very much for a very concise and very informative lecture. And I don't think anybody can teach optics like you. So thank you once again for reviving all my memories for me. Thanks, everybody. And all the kids who have attended today's lecture, please go back because optics is not something very simple. You have to go and do the YouTube channel and see this video again and again to understand. We'll put a few questions on spherical equivalent and transposition after a few days. And after you have understood it and you have solved the examples, if you still have some problems, you can come back to us. So Sumit, if you don't mind, we can finish the meeting.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am and sir, for your time.
Yeah, thank you so much. And thank you for waiting.
Thank you, Neeta, madam. And thank you, Bhatti, sir. It was a master class.
Thanks. I enjoyed myself as well. And plus, it forced me to do a little work for a change.
Sir, this video will remain etched in the memory on our BOA channel.
It is something actually, which is not very easy to teach, and you made it so simple, sir. Maybe because we know we understand it, for the kids, they will have to do it again and again.
Actually, everybody talks big, but when you look at the number of views, you'll really understand how many people really want to see it or not.
Sir, I'll go back and see it again.
Okay. So that's one guaranteed view.
Definitely. Yeah. And I think even Swapnesh will see it.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you so much for coordinating all this.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good night, everybody. Bye.
Good night.
Good night.